Okay, I'm so sorry about that. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us on World Environment Day. To our audience, I think you'll be watching us on YouTube. So if you have any questions throughout the session, we have some phenomenal people here. You can ask them and we'll try our best to answer them all. Moving on, I'm just going to give a brief introduction to the session before handing it over to my co-moderator. So this is the first time we've managed to get all of the movements in India, the youth movements, doing wonderful work towards the same cause of climate justice, social justice. And this is just to initiate a dialogue between all of the movements and just figure out how we work, what our synergies are. Also, you know, just show the people what we do and how we work. So yeah, I'm just going to move on and give the mic to Tarun to introduce the panelists for today.
Good evening, everyone. Once again, welcome to the panel discussion today. I'd like to start by introducing our first guest, Ms. Archana Sarang. Ma'am has been a member of the UN Secretary General's Youth Advisory Group on Climate Change, and she has also been the ex-president of PISS since 2017-2018. Welcome, ma'am. Thank you for joining us today. Our next guest is Shrijani. Shrijani is a member of Youth for Climate India. Shrijani is a part of the, I'm sorry, Shrijani is currently a sociology student in Hindu College, Delhi University. She's also heading the learning team at Youth for Climate India, where she works on creating resources for climate literacy and collecting primary and secondary information on various environmentally and socially determined projects in the country. Shrijani, thank you for joining us today. Next, we have Pratik. Pratik is from Yugma Network. Pratik is a final year student, law student. He coordinates Yugma Network's Environmental Justice Clinic and is interested in aiding local environmental and social justice struggles and movements through legal intervention. Pratik, thank you for joining us today. From Let India Breathe, we have Anna. Anna is a communications volunteer with Let India Breathe and a journalism graduate with passion for social and climate justice. They are actively working in climate advocacy and communications to create a more just society. Anna, thank you for joining us for this session. From Climate Front India, we have Salim. He's an 18-year-old and the Vice President and Head of Collaboration and Expansions Department in Climate Front India. Currently pursuing MBBS, he has been an active social and political climate activist from his early teenage years. Salim, thank you for joining us today. From NEPM, we have Priya. Priya has worked on environmental and social justice issues in 20 years. Since the last 20 years, she is working closely with grassroots movements and non-governmental organizations that focus on climate, energy, gender equality, and forest rights. Previously, she has worked with groups like Greenpeace, the Right to Food Campaign, Action Aid, and Oxfam. She has been closely associated with Adivasis and village communities in Mahan, Madhya Pradesh. Thank you for joining us today. We have Nupur next. She is a 36-year-old climate concerned citizen. For the last 12 years, she has been working as a sustainability consultant in Bangalore. Her professional experiences revolved around urban development with a focus on environment, energy conservation, urban forests, etc. In her off time, she has worked on animal welfare programs. Since the last year, she has decided to move to a small village and hopes to make a community climate resistant. She is an architect by academic qualifications and a mother of two dogs. Thank you, Nupur, for joining us today. And from Fridays for Future India, we have Lakshya. Lakshya has been a climate organizer since the beginning of Fridays for Future in India. He's also a student, a member of Polluters Out. Thank you for joining us today, Lakshya. I'd like to start this session by asking each and every member on the panel to give an introduction of your movement, your campaigns, and anything that you wish to share with the audience within 1 minute. I'd like Anna, if you could go first.
Hello everyone, thank you for having me. I'm so excited that all of us are here talking today. So I am from Let India Breathe. I am a communications volunteer there. We are a climate communications collective that we're working pan-India to amplify marginalized voices, voices that are mostly missed by the mainstream. We're bringing light to environmental crimes, and we're looking for a more just society. We're building and working towards a more just society. Right now, we have been working with Dumna, Hasdeo, Lakshadeep, and Andaman primarily. And yeah, I'm really excited to see what everyone else is up to.
Thank you so much. Shrijani, would you like to go next?
Sure. Hi, everyone. Really glad to be here. Hope you are having a great day. So at Youth for Climate India, our mission is to make climate justice a priority for people and politics. And the primary aim is that most of us and most of our movements tend to be reactive, you know, when governments keep bringing up environmentally unsound projects and we sort of react to it. But our initiative is to sort of intervene at the very beginning when they are making EIAs or when they are, you know, sort of working on it initially. So currently we are working on two things, forest fires in Uttarakhand and the Umgod River Dam, which is coming up in Meghalaya.
Thank you so much, Shrijani. Priya, would you like to go next?
Yes, thank you, Tarun, for having me over to interact for this interesting interaction. I represent NAPM, the National Alliance of People's Movement here. The National Alliance of People's Movement is a large network of more than 350 organizations, mostly grassroots movements, not organizations. They are grassroots movements fighting for Jal Jangal Jameen. So they stand up for the forest, the water resources, as well as land rights. So it's a wide network across India in different parts of the country, basically. And they are all very grassroots movements who've been fighting mining projects, other developmental projects, infrastructure projects, and we basically are part of this large network and work with many others too. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Prateek, would you like to go next?
Sure. Thank you for having me. I represent the Yugma Network. I'm a law student. And so the Yugma Network is essentially this youth collective. And what we try to do is essentially to broaden the discourse on environmental and social justice. So we have sort of different channels in Yugma Network. What we are trying to do essentially is bring, you know, communities and languages which have been neglected by the mainstream sort of discourse into the conversation about environmental justice. And sort of what we also try to do at the Environmental Justice Clinic is to, you know, enforce the legal rights of various communities and in order to aid those struggles in the court and also using, you know, the law outside the courts to sort of make legal interventions, you know, in order to realize these goals of environmental justice and social justice. So yeah, that's a bit about us. Thanks.
Thank you, Prateek. Archana, ma'am, would you like to go next?
Yeah, so Johar everyone, and I'm very happy to be here. I feel so happy that, you know, we all have come here and interacting. By profession, I'm a researcher. I have been working on research and advocacy, specifically in terms of implementation of Forest Rights Act in India. And thereby my research interest has been in terms of looking how indigenous rights, rights of Adivasi and forest dwelling communities and climate action is linked together, thereby emphasizing that how indigenous communities and Adivasi communities are the ones who are most contributing towards climate action, but they are the ones who are frontliner in terms of impacts of climate crisis. And apart from that, being part of the UN Secretary General's Youth Advisory Group on Climate Change, our role is to bring the voices of youth, specifically the challenges which they are facing in terms of their countries, and bring it to the Secretary General, wherein give him inputs on his climate action strategy, and also at the same time reach out to the young people with the climate action strategy and get their feedback as to how we can ensure that the countries can implement the climate action strategy. And I feel it is very, very important for me to be here listening what all the youth groups are doing, so that, you know, it is also to take away and get back to him and saying that this is what is happening in India, this is what the youth is seeking and demanding in India. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Nupur, would you like to go next?
Hello, everybody. It's really wonderful to see all of you and quite excited for this session. I'm representing SAPAC today. SAPAC is a rainbow coalition that was started in 2019. The intent of the organization was to bring about all environment-related activist groups across Southeast Asia. So far, we have been involved in getting a lot of coalition done with Bangladesh and Sri Lanka for various projects involving ports and mining rights, and especially coal, with all the new last year's activities happening. A few of the senior members in our group also got being involved in a couple of PILs that were signed for the railway line that's coming up in North Karnataka, as well as the EIA draft. PILs take a lot of time, so the end of the tunnel is still quite far away. Let's see how we can all of us work together in this session now.
Thank you so much. Salim, would you like to go next?
Hi everyone. So I'm Salmin Hussain. I'm currently pursuing MBBS from GMC Kathua, and I'm the Vice President of Climate Front India and the head of the Collaborations and Expansions Department. So, like as Sri Jani also said, that their organization tends to like be more of a preventive kind of organization. We work on the same principle. Like we see that, like we have seen that most of the climate organizations today, they tend to be more reactive. But our principles tend to be more of like preventive. We try to prevent the basic source of chaos. We try to stop it. We also were involved in initiating the Friends of River Tavi campaign in Jammu, where we were like able to voluntarily clean the River Tavi. We are in the process. We are actually in the middle stages, and we have been able to clear around 7,000 kgs of garbage. We have handpicked 7,000 kgs of garbage from that river. We're also currently involved in the Save Raika and the Save Dumna protests as well. So like, yeah, our organization, as all the organizations here, is a pan-India organization. So we actually work on like preventive measures to spread the word of climate justice and awareness. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'll hand it over to our own team member, Lakshya. You want to go next?
Hi guys, it's an honor to be here with you all. Probably I don't think Fridays for Future as a whole needs much introduction, because it has been so popularized in the social media pop culture in that sense. But it's for like the record. Fridays for Future has been a youth movement led by youth and worked all over the globe, maybe, but for like FF India, we have been focused on different aspects of and different campaigns over the time. Recently, the more majorly when the whole country was going through COVID, so like everyone intensely and on individual basis together came like in the team of Fridays for Future and started working tirelessly for COVID relief. So it was remarkable and a humbling experience to be like working with the team we have in Fridays for Future. Yeah, probably that's my points.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Tamanna, over to you.
Yeah, I second Lakshya. It's an honor to actually be here and watch this panel. And I mean, it's very clear that we have such a wide range of talents and backgrounds. I'm going to jump right in with the first question, which is, I'm sure we're all on social media. We've all come across each other's organizations, probably even each other's names. And some of us are more preventive in our principles. Some of us are more active. Some are reactive. So it's very clear that there's a synergy here. We can sort of work together and collaborate towards the same cause. So my question is, how do you think we can do that? Have you experienced this before where some of us have collaborated on a certain campaign and we've got good responses? Or in the future, how do you think, given that environmental dilutions are increasing, we might have more campaigns and maybe in the future we can collaborate and reduce the load on each other? So yeah, that's my question. And I'm going to start with Prateek from Yugma Network.
Hi, right, that's a very interesting and very important question, I feel. I think the first step sort of that we could take is to sort of reanalyze our own politics and in order to basically come on a single front about our politics. And I think as environmental organizations and as organizations who are fighting for climate justice, some sort of basic lines should not be crossed and should be common amongst all organizations. I mean, sure, we can change our strategies or use different sort of approaches to the thing, but politically, I think we need to be sort of aligned. And I think in order to make some sort of real social impact, it is at the end of the day, our political commitment and our political sort of underpinnings that really make a change. So what I basically mean is, if you are an actually committed climate justice organizations, you cannot be for corporations having so much power politically. You cannot be for government organizations completely ignoring any sort of procedural environmental laws that are in place. So these sort of basic commitments, if we can have a sort of discussion on it and basically agree with each other, and those sort of political underpinnings, if those are sorted out, I'm sure we can create various sort of synergies between us and sort of work together. So I mean, that could be an initial point that I feel we could really use.
Yeah, thanks for that, Prateek. It's actually a really good point. And I'm gonna move to Anna from Let India Breathe. I know I've seen Let India Breathe doing a lot of collaborative campaigns. So if you could tell us a little bit about how that's helped or changed your actions.
Hi, thank you so much, Prateek. Those were really great points. In fact, I think Let India Breathe has pretty much worked with all organizations here. So I think the one thing that we always think of at Let India Breathe is keeping our ear to the ground, looking at what the marginalized people are saying, looking at what is really happening at the grassroots level. So what Prateek said about politics, we need to have certain foundations and certain even organizational congruency when it comes to that. Like, we need to be functioning in similar manners so that when we come together and work together, we're sort of on the same lines when we're thinking of what is the communication strategy, what is the campaign strategy. That is what I would say. And also, definitely we have to be questioning those in power. We need to be asking for corporate accountability. We need to be asking for governmental accountability. We, as a basic principle, we need to be striving for justice. And maybe what we could be doing is coming together and thinking of ourselves as a community, since all of us are, we are working towards the same cause. So where does that resilience come from? What is climate resilience? You cannot work towards building that resilience in isolation. So perhaps working towards creating a more wholesome environmental community.
Yeah, definitely. I totally agree with that, thinking of us all as one community. And I'm going to pass it on to Nupur. What are your thoughts on this?
Working together is, more than trying, figuring out how to work together, I think all of us together will have to accept and understand the only way forward is together. In isolation, there is very limited that we can do. Everybody has their own small domain in which they are able to influence or have some impact. but it is together that we can really achieve our targets. And more or less, most of our targets are in line with each other. So rather than it becoming an add-on, I think that should be one of the focuses we have. A few things that would work well when we work together is having a lot of transparency between our self organizational values and as a collective value for a project. The work that Let India Breathe did with EIA was fantastic, was amazing. And if you could get similar synergies and similar enthusiasm together, I think a lot can be achieved. This works very well in online, but will definitely work very well when actually talking about a ground level meeting physical projects where a lot of the crisis that we are talking about is still not penetrated. So if we have to reach that level, we really need to buckle up and hold hands and run towards it.
Totally agree. That's like, I think it's a beautiful thought we all should remember following this panel as well. I want to move on to Archana, ma'am. I think all of us are familiar with her work. We all look up to her. And I think, Archana, ma'am, you have a different viewpoint to this since you, in your individual capacity, have worked with a lot of our organizations. So what do you think about this, about moving forward as a collective community?
I would like to start by saying that I feel happy to be part of this environmental youth groups in India, and specifically if I say those present here, because if I see, things have changed a lot, which I feel personally. Things were not this way. Like, people did not talk about social justice when it was climate action. It was not this way. And it was not embracing this way, coming together, which I feel is a drastic leap of change which has happened, which I can very proudly say that we are doing it and we are making effort. So I would like to start with saying that we have started coming together as a collective with pushing forward for, you know, social justice, climate justice. And I'm also very happy to see the range of voices which we are trying to bring in, whether it is Dalit voices, whether it is Adivasi and forest dwelling communities. So I would like to appreciate all for that effort, because that is a change which I have seen. And that is a change which I feel that we all have gone a much more deeper, moving way, way beyond than, you know, just plantation things and things like that, but into a deeper level. So this comes as a sense of appreciation that we have that same kind of understanding which is there. But I would like to also reiterate what Prateek said, which was very, very important, that a standpoint or, you know, what is, like, for example, if we see from a global perspective, what is the standpoint of India's youth in environmental debate? So, you know, coming up with that manifesto or coming up with that stand wherein we all are, you know, giving endorsement that this is what. So for that, you know, we'll have to also brainstorm amongst us. We may not agree at certain stands. We may not agree at this, but that is what it is. But initiating that and having that standpoint will be very, very crucial, because we have to be as one team to, you know, tackle or to defend or, you know, to act in this space, whether it is in the national level or global level. And for that matter, also many people will look up to us and are looking up to us in terms of what is happening in terms of, just a minute, sorry.
I just wanted to remind the speakers that please feel free to talk in Hindi and English both. So whatever is more convenient, or you could use a mix of Hindi and English both. So just putting that out there.
Hello.
Yeah,
I'm so sorry. Yeah. So I would like to reiterate that having that standpoint would be very crucial in terms of highlighting what is something which is the standard rules of do's and don'ts, or in terms of a ideological, or, you know, in terms of a perspective. And apart from that, the last thing which I would like to say in this point is, how do we go ahead? Is I bring this as a concern, and I would like to hear more with you all, that you know, there is everyday crisis happening in terms of climate crisis, but how much are we capable in terms of our mental health? Because we have to go a long, long way in this. So again, that is a thing I pose up to you all, that how do we work together in lessening burdening of each other in terms of thematics, in terms of everyday current things. So I think that is something which we'll have more brainstorming and thinking as to how we come as a collective, wherein there is lesser effort, but also taking care of each other, because we have to go a long way. So that is one of the concern and, you know, proposing what do we do. So thank you.
Thank you, Archana. We'll definitely have to touch on the mental health aspect that ma'am said. That's very important. Before we move on to that, I just want to get thoughts from Salmin on synergies between the movements moving forward.
So greetings, everyone, again. So like everyone just said, like how we can like collaborate and be synergistic to each other. So like I would just like to give you some examples as to like, as Nupur ma'am said, like as to how we can face the crisis on like on ground terms, like on ground, basically when we're practically performing the like the tasks which we plan online. So for example, when we started the River Tavi campaign, the Friends of River Tavi movement, a lot of organizations came to help us. They became a part of our campaign, and like they were always ready to like be a part of our drives, be a part of our like donation campaigns, fundraisers. So because we had a common aim, we had a common objective, and it was quite apolitical. So then, like as Prateek said, that we also have to like kind of compromise our political backgrounds and stuff when we come together in climate awareness. When we went for the Save Raika campaign, which for those who don't know, for those of you who don't know about the Raika campaign, actually Raika is a 850 hectares large forest in Jammu, which is being cleared to, which is being cleared, deforested to construct a high court, construct the new high court complex. So we were against it, and we tried to bring together the same organizations which were involved with us in the Friends of River Tavi campaign. But since this was a pro-government project, various organizations which had affiliations with the government or like which were kind of politically and religiously or socially motivated, had backings from that side, they automatically backed out. So we need to see that whenever we are doing anything, whenever we are doing any like protest, or we are working on working against any crisis, we need to see that like the member organizations have the same way of thinking, have the same ideologies, they have the same working backgrounds. We can actually collaborate with everyone. But the main thing which we need to see here is the ideological differences. The least the ideological differences there are, the better synergical, the better, like we can say, we can work better synergistically, we can have less antagonistic effects. So like, yeah, this is what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Yeah, that's very true. And thank you for the examples of that. With this, I'll move to Priya ma'am from NAPM. What are your views on this?
Great to listen to all of you. In terms of how do we, movements collaborate, I think one needs to understand very clearly how environmental movements, women's rights movements, and land rights movements have worked in the past. Most of the time you've seen that we've tended to work more in silos. You know, the environmental movements have focused on environment, whereas the women's rights movement have focused more on gender and related issues. So whereas in the real world, one needs to acknowledge and understand the fact that there is an interconnectedness of issues. You know, environment does not operate in a box or a silo. It is not a standalone issue. It is interconnected very, very deeply with many other issues. It is connected with land rights, it's connected with water rights, it's connected with forest rights, it's connected with the dignity of tribal communities, it's connected with livelihoods of communities, all kinds of issues. And it is connected with gender rights. So we need to kind of understand what these intersectionalities are. So ideology and understanding and, partnering with like-minded, ideological groups is one part of the thing. The other thing is to understand what these intersectionalities are and to reach out to other movements, for example. And so we don't want a situation where, when an environmentalist is attacked, you want the feminist movements, you want the water rights people, you want the land rights groups, you want the lawyers, you want everybody to kind of come together and raise their voice or add their voices in solidarity. And at the end, so that's one part. I think the whole thing of looking at issues in a connected manner and saying that all issues are interconnected, acknowledging that and building alliances and solidarities across movements and organizations is very important. The other thing is in the current times, no one group, or movement or organization in the country can achieve anything by itself. Alliances is the most important thing. We need to definitely ally with like-minded organization, like-minded people, like-minded research institutions, and individuals in order, because this is a big political fight. It's not like a small thing which can be just fought and won by a small bunch of people. So we need to kind of understand the strength of solidarity and alliance building and how we should walk that extra mile to build that alliance, which will eventually strengthen our movement, is something that we need to keep at the core of our strategy at all times, I think. Similarly, how do we build collective strategies? So not just alliances, how do we build collective strategies? Are we able to understand when a mine is proposed in a forest, there is an issue of Adivasi rights, there is an issue of women losing their control over forest resources, there is a conflict between the forest department and the tribal communities, there is a corporate loot, there is violation of other forms of human rights when people are arrested and jailed, there's crackdown on activists. So there are a wide range of things that come. So how do we kind of collectively strategize is also something one needs to kind of keep in mind. The third thing I think which is very important is pooling capacities and strengths. If you look at organizations or movements across the country, whether they are people fighting on the ground or, people more, in the rural areas or in the forest, or whether it's more urban-centric youth groups or, urban-centric people who are fighting air pollution or, a hawkers group based in a city or say a rag pickers, a group of people who are working with rag pickers, there needs to be, I think, in each of these groups have their own strengths and capacities. In the current situation, there is a need. Like we, if you look at environment, especially when it's put in, contrast with the whole development thing, you're always in the space where you are fighting big corporations who are very, very powerful. In order to pull them down, in order to defeat them, you need a multi-pronged strategy. You can't just have, say, a ground movement. You'll need a legal strategy. You will need a media strategy. You will need a research, strategy to bring out information that will inform the strategy on the ground. So how do we kind of, and different groups, different organizations, different individuals have different strengths in this space. It's important to pool all these, strengths and capacities also in the alliance, basically. So somewhere I think what is most important is this process of engagement, aligning, solidarity, pooling resources, standing together, looking at issues in an integrated manner and fighting it together.
Thank you so much, Priya, and that was extremely insightful. I think a lot of great points. With that, I'll move to Srijani. What are your views on this? And what are your views on what Priya ma'am just said? I'm sure we all learned a lot from that.
Yeah, I think most of the things I wanted to say have been covered, and especially by Priya ma'am. So I'll just sort of add to it. So when you ask me that question, the first thing which comes to my mind is the fact that we all mentioned that this is the first time all of the major pan-India environmental groups are coming together. So I think the first thing would be to sustain this conversation and engagement, and like not just before global climate strikes, but like every month have a call and, you know, so to understand what kind of work we are doing and what is the common point. And I think politically speaking, or like speaking in terms of our theory of change, somewhere we do have that basic groundwork there that we all agree that climate action has to come from governments. We have to question the corporate culture. We have to question corporates, and not, it's not going to be based, or it's not going to come out of individual action. So that is one base that we already have, which is a great thing. Now, other than the sustained thing, I really believe in what Priya ma'am said, and I'll give you an example from the EIA resistance, right? Because there were some really good practices there, which I noticed. So everyone sort of played to their strengths there. You know, some organizations are really good with online campaigning, whereas some organizations have a good legal aid and they know, you know, they have that kind of backing, which a lot of us don't. Right. And a lot of organizations have a pre-existing network of translators. So everyone did what they are good at. And that's why we sort of pooled our resources. And that's why it was that big. Right. And also what I've seen working with different organizations is the ones we have really good relations with are the ones we have, you know, are the ones that we have sort of helped, or they have helped us back in terms of legal aid or, you know, building campaigns. Some organizations are really good with the whole thing about organizational structures, and while some other youth movements are struggling with that. So basically helping each other upskill really builds that kind of trust. So I think that's what my answer would be.
Yeah, I completely agree. Also, thank you for bringing up EIA. I think to this day, the fact that it's still so fresh in people's minds is because so many of us came together and made it one of the largest campaigns. It was one of the greatest. And moving to Lakshay, I know that you've been a part of a number of different organizations as well. And I just want to get your views on this conversation that we're having.
I think there is nothing much to add, because Priya has so comprehensively covered almost every aspect of how can we do this. One, like in a different perspective to put it, there is not any point of contention between anyone or any movement on basic principles, broadly terming them, and like, how can things be done and what changes we require on a broader scale. So for that reason, I think what Archana also pointed out, that we need a mutual consensus, a minimum consensus manifesto point sort of, where we can put out at least what we think on a minimum scale we agree with. And another point is like, maybe this crisis of COVID also has shown us that only like coming together we can sustain ourselves. And in a crisis which is like 30 times bigger than COVID, or like 3,000 times bigger than COVID, is climate crisis, or like historic proportion. So we can't imagine to face it alone with like, we can't, that would be foolish in a way. So we have to come together in any way, like find the common grounds and reach out. And also just a point like from my side, that we need to create safe spaces between ourselves to engage in conversations which are hard, basically, and not judge us on like ideological levels, because that is more important right now to connect. Otherwise, we are not any different with the PR agencies running the government.
Yeah, agreed. Also, accepting the fact that we all might come from different backgrounds, we might have different experiences, viewpoints, but everyone's matters. And also the fact that we all are allowed to learn and grow from it and become better. Completely agree. I'm going to move on to the next part of the conversation, which is with the kind of work that we all are doing. Lot of mental health issues, burnout, eco-anxiety is given, it happens. I want to ask you, how do you deal with it in your movement? How do you take care of the mental health and the burnouts of your volunteers and of yourselves as well. So I'll start with Lakshay this time.
Okay, so this is going to be interesting because like for internally FFF India also, we had this conversation somewhat this conversation yesterday, like an initiation of that on this topic. So it's really I don't think there is much scope of handling things very properly, like a perfect guide sort of. It isn't there, to be honest. But if we want to be there, we first need to not rationalize someone's opinion. Whenever someone wants to come and talk or give anything, give any opinion about anything, the first reaction of this is to rationalize those things. And which is actually not so good for anyone. If I'm speaking and like, I probably don't have the full knowledge of it, but we should try to approach it in a different sense, in an individual emotional sense also. And creating the safe space is equally important within the movements to communicate. And third point would be to increase our conversations more in individual senses within the movement. For example, like not only working and like discussing work all the time, but having a regenerative time also on weekly basis is a good start, I think, where we can have things like that. For example, like in our organization I'm a member of, Polluters Out, we have something called JEDI committee. So it's like Justice, Equity, Diversity, Inclusivity committee. So it makes us at least for the sake of it, that anyone can be can approach it freely without any sense of, I would say, any negative thoughts about that, and trying to be more inclusive. These are first steps probably towards that.
Yeah, I second that. I'm going to move the mic to Nupur ma'am from SAPACC. What are your views on this, mental health and burnout?
That's actually a very important topic, and to a large extent, a lot of focus on SAPAC has not happened related to mental health. Honestly, in Indian society or Indian mindset, in general, we don't have a lot of focus on mental health. Thankfully, in SAPAC, we have a lot of senior activists who have done a lot of grassroots level. To give you an example, one of our members, Shri Kumar, has a wonderful farm, and a bunch of us actually ended up spending around 10 days in his farm, just, you know, shouting and screaming in the soil and working with the soil. That kind of helps, but that is not a solution for every day or every person. So everybody, including SAPAC, is kind of trying to struggle how to find that safe space or find that breakout room so that we can just go there, scream, shout, and come back freshened up. We are working on it. I don't think we have a solution yet. I don't think anybody here has a solution, and we'll have to find a space, safe space.
That's why you're asking the question. Please go on.
I have personally faced that I think we should be focusing on. One is we tend to put in a lot of emotions in our work. A lot of heartache goes in this activism world. That stresses us out for sure. But knowing what we know and knowing what will happen tomorrow and not being able to connect that with our family and friends outside of this little circle of activists, I think for me personally, that is very stressful. And I can scream and shout to my parents, ki bhaiya dekho suno, but childhood friends, college friends, and that for me is a little more stressful than the actual work or not being able to sleep for a week at an end. And that is something that we need, we should together maybe find a solution where we can communicate our problems better to our family and friends.
Yeah, completely agree. I'm gonna pass the mic to Salmin. How do you guys deal with mental health burnout?
So, Nupur ma'am raised some very beautiful points. So, like, this is like the main problem behind every eco health issue, like mental health issue, which is like we haven't had a solution yet. So I have myself personally been like a victim of this burnout, this eco anxiety, because for me, I have personally spent a lot of time like actually fighting with the government officials, actually going to the DC office and secretariat and like literally fighting with the officials. And when it all goes in vain, it literally gives like a little heartache and headache, everything. It just causes a little burnout. So what we came up with was like, we made this separate private account for our organization, which was like kind of a meme account for everyone, which was kind of a recreational Instagram account for everyone. So we kind of shared memes of every volunteer, usually consensually, of course. So we shared memes and we shared videos. We usually tagged them. And so what this like actually even helped us in making closer bonds. This helped in bonding. This also like helped in like recreational, this also helped with recreational purposes. So like this actually helped a lot, but on a major, like on a broader perspective, as Nupur ma'am said, we still haven't got a solution for that. It has actually like eased out a lot of burden, but talking on a broader perspective, we still need like some solid solutions.
Although that private group thing sounds really nice. I'm going to ask Prateek, what are your views on this and how do you guys address this?
Thank you. These are such great ideas. Just hearing, especially Nupur's idea about going to that farm and screaming. I mean, it's really nice to know. This is actually a very personal sort of question for me, at least because eco-anxiety and especially climate anxiety was sort of my foray into this activism space or whatever we do. And it's not just... just disappointment of things not working out. I'm actually very scared of just looking at what's coming out of climate science and the research, especially. I mean, just yesterday, I don't want to be like a buzzkill or whatever, but just like recently, I read about the Eastern Siberian Shelf, and I think so the amount of methane that's gonna go out when it sort of melts or whatever, it's just going to be disastrous. And in the next 5 years, probably I think we're going to cross the 1.5 degree global temperature change. I know it's all very depressing and all that, but I think that's the key thing. And I think I haven't personally addressed it, that it at times just feels very futile. Everything, every sort of activism. And because you just look at how scary climate catastrophe is. So that is sort of a question that, as everyone said, I really do not have any answers to, and it's actually very scary. What I think personally helps me is sort of because we are in this legal space, and unlike activism out on the streets, the legal space has clear winners and losers. So that sort of keeps you motivated, and you sort of feel that at least you are doing something. I think it's really just fooling yourself into believing that things are working out. I wanted to ask this question actually to everyone. How do you really deal with not just eco-anxiety, but climate anxiety? Just thinking about how little, at the end of the day, whatever we do, we are doing so little, right? Just everyone internationally. So it's just these questions I don't think we can really answer in a webinar, because, I mean, just the amount of existential danger that is there, it's just not, it's sort of not, it's not easy to answer. Yeah,
plus like you said, the fact that every day there's new news, there's new research, and not most of it is good. With that question, I'll like to ask Priya, who might have a bit of a different perspective. Would you like to answer Prateek's question?
I don't know if I'm going to be able to answer your question, Prateek, but having kind of worked very closely with an anti-mine movement on the ground under very exceptional circumstances in a far-off district, leaving your family, your child, and working under very, very stressful conditions, I've had that experience for 9 years of my life. But I think what I feel is that we all need to understand that, you know, this climate, the issue of climate change and the crisis that and the disasters that come with it is a huge issue. It's a mammoth issue. Okay. And there are a large number of people who are fighting it, but it's only, and you're fighting with very powerful people. You need to really understand that this battle is a battle. It's a David versus Goliath battle. Okay. And the moment you acknowledge that, you know, you need to also start having this feeling that everything I do, you know, there may be roadblocks, you know, I may feel helpless, but everything that each person, each one of you is doing is adding some value to this large ocean of resistance, and that is the thought with which you have to constantly go. I think what the whole burnout issue, you know, is something that we've all faced, and we've spoken about it so much among our activist friends in the movements. Every third person that you know is on antidepressants and on anti-anxiety pills, which is the unfortunate situation, because, you know, we are too emotional and we are compassionate and we feel, we are so much our convictions are so strong. We really want this battle to be won by all of us. Our commitments, our passion, you know, all of this together pushes us into this mental, break kind of a situation. But one needs to understand that, you know, the solidarity that we have amongst ourselves is not just solidarity of issues that we fight. It's also a friendship and a solidarity that, you know, we have as human beings, you know, with each other as friends, as sathis, as comrades who are walking the same path. So we just can't collaborate on issues and say that, okay, abhi khatam ho gaya, matlab hamara andolan khatam ho gaya, we won't look at our comrade, we won't interact with our comrade. So, you know, somewhere we need to kind of break that thing. This whole thing also, you know, activists are very strong people. They are not like normal people. They shouldn't break down. Let's kill all of this. We are all very normal people. Yet, yes, we are very passionate about certain issues. We are committed. We want to walk the extra mile and do things. But we are all normal people. It's okay to cry. It's okay to break down. It's okay to take breaks. It is okay to say, I don't like to read something on coal mining. I want to just, pull out a novel and, or watch a comedy movie. You know, it's just human to do that. So accept that we are all human beings. We cannot actually go on like this. The other thing, because I'm saying this from my own experience, you know, after fight, working with the communities and fighting a mine in Mahan for 9 years, you know, I made the mistake of living, that fight day in and day night, you know, in so much that, you know, from morning to night, we would work 18 hours and, we never had food. We never thought of, and in the end, what happens is, you know, you are down with ulcer. You have multiple health problems. You are a anxiety knot who's not communicated with family. A lot of people here said that, you know, your school friends, your families don't agree with your ideology. Yes, they don't. I think we need to acknowledge and understand that it's a diverse world and everybody is learning. Each person's life is a journey. And their exposures, the things that their life experiences basically decide their perspectives and, you know, their ideologies and all of that. So we need to kind of accept that not everybody is an activist, you know, there are people, and it's okay. Not everybody needs to be an activist. You know, all you need to be is a sensitive human being, you know, who is sensitive towards the planet, towards other human beings and towards these issues. You don't need to be an activist who is working 24/7 for an issue, you know, that's not possible. So I think, you know, I've learned from my own experience that, you know, communications with your friends and family who may not agree with your point of view from time to time is very, very important. For the 9 years that I spent there, most of the time I lived in a, you know, bubble where I only communicated with the community, with other activists who contributed to the fight, with talking about strategy. You lived in that, and when you come out, like the Mahan fight was ultimately the mine that we fought for got deallocated, and I still remember when suddenly the government deallocated the mine. there was this vacuum, you know, from working 18 hours a day to suddenly coming back and everybody saying, oh, wow, very good. Now you guys need a break. And we were like, OK, but I don't know what to do now. You know, there's this blank feeling of I really lost touch with the rest of the world and what others do. And, you know, because you've got yourself so much into it. So I think it's important to take breaks. It's important to keep communications consistently with friends, families. It's important to hear each other. It's important to share with each other. And most importantly, it's important to acknowledge that the issues that we are fighting are larger than life. We should remember not to beat ourselves down. You know, that's totally unfair if we do that to us or anybody else in our circle.
Thank you so much. I think a lot of the things you said are reminders that especially as youths, as younger people, we need to remember. Most of us are just starting out on our activist journeys. It's very important to remember that. And especially the part where you said it's okay to take a break. A lot of us all the time keep forgetting that. So thank you. And I'm just going to ask Archana to add something here. What are your views on this?
Very amazingly, comprehensively, it's very inspiring to hear Priya. So it's like the most of things have been covered. What I would like to say from my personal experience is it took a lot of time for me to register in my mind that this fight is a long run. It's not a sprint 100 meter. It's a long run which we have to fight. Also took me to realize that I may not be alive to see what I fought for, but my presence at this moment is very crucial in whatever I can contribute. So it's that. There have been days, there's so much of restlessness, but then I just made me register in my mind, which again took a lot of time, that I cannot speak up in all the issues because there are days when I'm not well. There are days when I'm out of network. There are days when I'm sick. There are days when my family needs me. But what is important is that taking break and not able to speak up at that moment is also okay, fine. Because what I believe in environmental justice, it itself is the point. Whether I'm able to speak on this issue, that issue, it should not count whether everyone is able to see or not. But what count is whether you are able to speak up on this climate justice movement, because we are human. We may not be able to say in every single issues which are happening every single day. So it took me a lot of time to make myself register, but there were times, you know, ये लोग बोल दे रहे हैं, ये लोग भी बोल दे रहे हैं, मेरे को भी बोलना है, पर बेड से उठा ही नहीं जा रहा है बोलने के लिए, टाइप करने के लिए. And in that time, you know what happens, you're not able to wake up from the bed, but because that the thing is, the urge is there, you're not able to speak, your health gets more deteriorated because the fact ki yaar main bol nahi pa rahi hu, mere ko bolna hai, theek rahoge tabhi to bologe. So this took me a lot of time to deal with this. And also I have started doing rationing of my phone time. This time to this time I'll be using phone, and this time to this time my notification will be on, because if I felt it was very crucial to deal with phone, because the moment you wake up in the morning, this flow of information, and the moment you go to the phone in the morning, then it's gone, because again it takes you effort to recharge yourself to work something. So rationing of phone timing has also helped me to keep myself a bit balanced and organized given the issues and inflow of things which is coming up. Also, I want to say the examples which I have heard, a last one. I have heard a lot from people ki, you know, Adivasi communities yahan pe itne kasht mein hain, is tarah se hain, itne pareshan hain, itne pratadit hain, aur tum yahan pe kya kar rahi ho? तुम कुछ भी नहीं कर रही हो उनके लिए, तुमको ऐसे करना चाहिए, तुमको वैसे करना चाहिए. तो देर आर पीपल हु विल कॉन्स्टेंटली से कि यू आर नॉट डूइंग एनीथिंग, विच इज लिटरली वेरी वेरी बैड. बट द थिंग इज कि पीपल विल से कि तुम कभी कुछ कर ही नहीं रहे हो. द फैक्ट इज कि यू आर वॉन्टिंग एंड हैव टेकन स्टेप to speak on these issues, contribute in it issue is something which we have to say ourselves ki main kar rahi hu. लोगों को पता हो चाहे ना हो मैं कर रही हूँ. किसी दिन मैं स्लो हो जाऊंगी, किसी दिन मैं तेज रफ्तार में रहूंगी, बट मैं कर रही हूँ एंड आई नो व्हाट पाथ आई हैव चूजन. सो वो एक खुद को सेल्फ मोटिवेट करना इज आल्सो वन ऑफ द वे टू गो, बिकॉज फॉर पीपल वी डू नथिंग और वी डू क्रेजी थिंग्स. सो दिस इज व्हाट इट इज एंड आई हैव सेट ऑफ फ्रेंड्स टू हुम आई कॉल एंड क्रिब की मेरे को वैसे फील हो रहा है, ये ऐसे गलत हो रहा है. So there is a set of people with whom took, and I totally relate with all of what said. Like none of my, a lot of friends don't understand this and don't engage in this. But again, as Priya said, it has to be slowly and gradually engaging with everyone. But as of now, also having people with whom you can go back to you and share things without thinking anything really, really helps. And for that matter, I see this group also, we can, you know, come back and share, this is happening, that is happening, I don't like this, I have this. So I think that will help. So that is, yes, it's also collectively protecting and helping each other.
Thank you so much, Arjuna, especially the point you said about my presence right now in this time matters. I think that really touched me. And yeah, thank you, Priya and Arjuna. The points you said, I think some things come only from experience. It was very enlightening. And I'm going to move to Anna. Would you like to say something about this?
I think everything I wanted to say is covered, but I really, really like the points about camaraderie. And, you know, understanding that what we're doing is enough. I think what's happening is that there is just this general sense of doom when it comes to this activism that we're engaging with. And what we need to do is we need our best to sustain hope. And that only comes with talking to each other, things like these right now. Like, I remember when Pratik was talking, all I could think was, like, this is exactly what we need. Like, we need to come together and talk about what's happening. At Let India Breathe, we more or less take time for ourselves whenever we need to. We say, like, I'm not having a great day, so I can't work today. But another space that I work at, it's a weather and climate justice newsletter sort of thing. There we do like a weekly listening circle, and where we just come and talk. Now, it can be very difficult to bring everyone together considering the very big organizations that we work with. But that's what I personally found helpful. Also, Nupur, when you were talking about your farmhouse, let me, we've been planning a trip for so long, but it's just been postponed like every month because of the pandemic.
Thanks, Anna. Sri Janu, do you have anything to add?
Sure. I think Priya wants to say something or hands up.
Yeah, I forgot one thing. You know, the other thing that activists or people in this sector or working on these issues are always, worried about is, you know, do I have to dress in a particular manner? Can I, like, by mistake also not afford to say something that's incorrect, you know, by a slip of a tongue? Am I supposed to, you know, only wear Hawaii chappal and, you know, use a jhola? No, I don't think so. That's one of the most, you know, like, there is this whole concept of, you know, putting you in a bracket and saying, like, I've seen, I faced this thing when, you know, there's a particular style of dressing when I'm in the villages, and when I am out here in the city, I wear something else. And there's this whole thing of judging, you know, you by saying, oh, but you are an activist. Do you wear these kind of clothes? Do you? So there is also this thing of, you know, coming out of that box and saying yes, and being unapologetic about your style of dressing, your speaking, all of this, and saying, with all of this, I have this set of values, and I subscribe to this ideology, and that's okay. You know, that we live in a diverse world. We have different kinds of people, and people are like this. Just accepting that with others, not being judgmental about others, as well as, you know, when others say this about you, to kind of just say that, look, I'm just like this. Be unapologetic about it.
Yeah, thank you for that. Also, along with that, when you say I'm an environmental activist, people are like, oh, do you use plastic? Do you eat non-veg? How can you be an environmentalist if you do that? And, you know, just saying that you don't have to be zero waste to be an environmentalist, that's not what it's about. That's a really important point. Thank you. Yeah, Shrini, can go ahead.
I mean, what Priya mentioned, I could literally rant about that. But I mean, you know, that image, that, because like on my Instagram, I share a lot of like social stuff and all of that. So sometimes when I do share memes, people are like, aren't you supposed to like, you know, talk about, and I'm like, can't I even share memes at this point? And like, I remember I went for this climate strike, and like, this guy literally, one, I don't even know, he's like, every other girl is wearing a kurta, why aren't you wearing a kurta? And I'm like, do I know you? Like, that was my literal reaction, I don't even know him. So yeah, but at a very personal level, hi dog, hello. Yeah, okay, so.
Special hi to Nupur's dog. So cute. Sorry, go on.
So at a very personal level, I think, see, at a like on a daily basis, we deal with very complex emotions as activists, as groups of activists. And even we have to acknowledge the fact within our groups, we have a lot of conflict sometimes. So dealing with those kind of emotions, and I feel like we don't talk about it enough. Right, the conflicts within our groups and how you deal with that, and you know, everyone's at like a very, sometimes it happens like they're at like very divided planes, and how do you deal with that? Then there's a lot of disappointment, defeat, and you know, just powerlessness. That's what I have been feeling, especially recently. So you have to deal with those things. And personally, like I have always been in the research wing of any organization. So it's a bit different from people who are sort of designing content or who are working on partnerships. I am reading 15 articles in a day about how people have been displaced or how they don't have enough to eat. And so the effect is sort of different within the group also. And the like in YFC, I lead a team of researchers. So even they are reading that constantly, right? So I need to keep that in mind. And how do we deal with that? For now, I mean, it's been working well. We have this in place that every 2 months you have to go on a 1 week break. Like you just have to. So my break is actually coming up. But then if it wasn't made mandatory, you know, because it wasn't earlier, I would just be like, okay, I have this work to complete. I have that work to complete. And like, that just happens, you know, I have all of this big checklist that I have to do. And then I don't take the break. So I really think this mandatory break has really helped. And we have these things every 2 weeks where we just come. I remember like a month ago, it was just like a session of 1.5 hours where people were just ranting. People just ranted for 1.5 hours. And then another session 2 weeks later was like a game. So what that does is it helps people, it helps to bring us together in a positive environment. And sometimes we have these healing sessions also where we have art therapy or we have these other kinds of therapies. And not every kind of therapy was my type, I'll be very honest. I'm not very expressive emotionally. So one of those therapies weren't, like those sessions weren't for me, but I really liked the other one. So we sort of accommodate everyone's interests. And I think it has been working out well till now. But of course, as I said, like complex emotions and wins kafi kam hota hai environmental movement, yeah, any movement mein, and defeats hi zyada hota hai. So yeah.
Yeah, I agree. And I think along with your suggestion of mandatory breaks and the what Archana said about compartmentalizing your phone time and all of that, some very good suggestions that I think all of us can consider even on an individual level in the movement moving forward. I'm going to move on to the last big question of the day, which is, I think, Archana, you mentioned, right, that in the recent terms, you've seen the conversations around this sphere are increasing a lot. There's a lot more inclusivity of different people, backgrounds, communities. So what change have you seen in your volunteers or your audience? And have you seen that there are more youth coming in? Have you seen that there are different communities wanting to join, more different conversations happening? So yeah, that's my question. And I want to start with Archana because you speak on a lot of global platforms. So have you seen this change happening on a global level as well?
Yes, I have felt that now people are willing to listen the perspective. But it's also very sad that it took so much time to listen to the Adivasi and forest dwelling and indigenous and rural communities, which is just so basic. It should have happened a way, way before. First. The second thing which I would like to see, I feel, is, you know, listening is just one part. Implementation is so very important, because, you know, there is situation wherein, you know, okay, we want Adivasis and forest dwelling communities or rural communities to be part of climate action discourse, debate, everything. Very nice. We want to hear to them. But your policies shows that you are not concerned about them. Your implementation shows that you are not concerned about it, which also brings me to the fact that to be vigilant, that creating awareness amongst youth and people is just one thing, but also engaging in policy level is another thing which requires a lot more effort we all to come together. So yes, there has been change in audience and there are people who are willing to listen, but I however feel that, you know, people feel that if you bring ground reality and nuances, bahut negativity ho raha hai yaar, nahi sunna hai. So that is again very crucial ki I personally have experienced when I say the good practices of indigenous rural communities and local communities, it's like, wow, very nice. They need to be involved. When I say those atrocities faced by those community members while conservation, while protecting the nature, it's like silent. So that's the dilemma and that's the irony which I feel. But it is, again, it's a long battle which I feel, wherein it is also to make or push the environmental movement, both in the global level and the national level, and for us also, that we have to tell the difficult part. We have to say the difficult narrative of climate justice movement, and to say that difficult movement or difficult narrative of climate justice movement, we need solidarity of each and everyone. So what I feel as we move ahead would be also to ensuring more and more youth voices of Adivasis, forest dwelling communities and other communities to ensure intersectionalities. And when we are saying that, you know, I personally feel, and I am also working to ensure and identifying more young Adivasis youth, so that, you know, it's not me coming and speaking. I want them to come and speak to you also, so that for that, it is also very crucial that we work in terms of language barrier and interpretations. And that is why I feel it would be very crucial that we need to have that mindset or the narrative that we want to hear the last person of this entire crisis or atrocity which is happening. So it's more and more participation and leadership which is important. Also, you know, it's also that kind of thing. It has been years of long injustice. How do we think that it will be rewinded ASAP? Or, you know, so it's a long battle, and bringing those narrative which is missed out in a more nuanced way and pushing forward, it is very important. At the end, I would also like to say that, you know, there is a connotation. Yes, fine, you know, bringing perspective of indigenous and local communities. We have heard this, we know this. But the thing is, you have heard this, you know this. Why are you getting bored of this? Because people are living it. And that is what it is. You need to access more and more spaces, and more narrative needs to be pushed forward. And that is why I feel good that everyone here is being pushing forward for both social, economic justice when we are talking about environmental justice.
Yeah, thanks, Arjuna. Some very good points. I mean, when you say that you don't want to hear the negative parts of a story, you're essentially again playing a role in covering what has been covered for all these years. Not good. And yeah, it's also important to know when to pass the mic to someone else, let them speak up, someone who hasn't been allowed to speak for a number of years. And I think even for us as volunteers in these movements, we need to keep that in mind. And I want to ask Nupur, you're working at a grassroots level right now. So what are your views on this? Have you seen any change in the work that you do?
My experience comes from two aspects of my life. One is when I was working in a proper urban corporate segment, where there was some basic awareness of waste segregation and plastic cum caro, and you know, a very high level understanding of climate crisis. And then coming to a rural community which has actually faced the impact of climate crisis, but does not have an understanding of the science or the magnitude of issue behind it. Both, I think it's like that elephant and the blind man wala story. Everybody's looking at it from a smaller perspective and not able to grasp the whole whole picture. Surprisingly, I found the rural India much more perceptive to the impact they see in front of them. Majority of the people are agri and from an agrarian society or an agrarian family, at least. So they know that if my yield has reduced or has changed, that is because of something. Or because if the rain is going to be a week delay, it actually physically impacts their livelihood. So the perception is much vaster. The problem, what I see here is the solution that they perceive as to climate crisis is to get into more technology or get into a more urban or a techno solution. So barish gadbad ho rahi hai to borewell ban dalo is, you know, how the thought process goes. But rainwater harvesting karo ya rain ponds banao, wo solution nahi aa pa raha hai. This also is strongly impacted by the kind of policies we see in the with our government, not just right now, but historically, from the whole Green Revolution movement in the late 70s to promoting your poly houses, so you're cyclone proof, right? The solutions that we are coming up to at a rural India is going to amplify the problem rather than solve it. Thankfully, I met a lot of interesting people in the last 1 year where they were willing to listen, and they have slowly thought of adopting some strategies to see if they can combat impacts of climate change, at least at their level. It's going to be a very slow, glacial slow journey here, unless and until you can get 100 people, 50 people who work with them on the soil and help them understand. Urban India, my experiences as a sustainable consultant also was same. To give you an example, for one of my projects as a high-rise residential building in a drought-prone city, it became difficult for me to explain to a builder that why he has to build a rainwater harvesting tank, even knowing that his cost of the project has increased because he's getting tanker water. तो आपको समझ आ रहा है कि आपके पास पानी नहीं है, आप यू आर स्पेंडिंग मोर ऑन टैंकर वाटर, बट यू आर स्टिल नॉट एबलिंग टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट स्पेंडिंग मनी ऑन रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग इज गोइंग टू बी इक्वली इंपॉर्टेंट समवेयर वी आर आई हैव नॉट अंडरस्टूड हाउ टू ब्रिज दैट गैप. देयर इज एन आइडेंटिफिकेशन ऑफ अ प्रॉब्लम, बट द सॉल्यूशन हैज नथिंग टू डू विद द ओरिजिनल प्रॉब्लम. इट इज जस्ट अबाउट हाइडिंग दैट प्रॉब्लम इन द बैकग्राउंड. आई डोंट नो, आई अज्यूम दैट साइंस एंड अवेयरनेस एंड शोइंग फैंसी रिसर्च पेपर इज एन आंसर. इट इज नॉट द आंसर. Nobody cares about research at all.
Thanks Nupur, and thank you for the bifurcation of like the urban and the rural thing. That was very interesting to me. And I'm going to ask Lakshay next. Have you seen a change in the audience with the work that you do?
Probably yes. And both no at some level, because in last 2 years really due to COVID, the whole climate movement along with the social movements in India happening, climate movement has been overshadowed in a lot of sense. So yeah, there has been a change in internal things, also how everyone who's working in climate spaces has grown more in intersectional terms, in democratic terms. They have perceived those values that they're much more important to get climate justice. We need to first work on social and economic justice because of like the whole terrible, miserable conditions imposed by decades of socioeconomic lunacy. So that kind of things needs to be taken into account and has been really been improving over the time. And for people, like, I just want to make this, we need as whole, like in broader terms, all our movements are mobilized more in terms of online social media platforms. So that is one limitation. And another one being that most of the things that is going on goes around in Hindi. So that limits us to a lot of things, because the people who have access to internet and social media and along with like knows English are the elite for like a major consideration, if we broadly say. So that leaves us that the most underprivileged and marginalized communities aren't in reach within our movements, basically. So we need to figure out a way to at least reach out in vernacular languages for the least, to say, and also increase our grassroots approach in a way somehow, like link everything together. And also on the think of like, as Nupur said, around how no one is interested in research. So yeah, in proper terms, no one is interested. For example, like Tamanna, as you are, you have been doing some really amazing translations for like basically converting the research into an easily understandable things, but they are in English. So we need to somehow manage to do that in vernacular languages and also not limit that to social media and print it out in real and reach out to grassroots level. That is more important, because that is the point which which can make a difference for a whole movement as a like climate movement in India, because that whole section is about like 60 to 70% of India hasn't been touched upon, and they don't know, and they are not interested because they don't know, they are not aware. So yeah, it's a long process, but we need to think of somehow reaching to that section.
Yeah, that's a very good point. In fact, yesterday I was in a talk where I think most of you must know Avinash Chanchal from Greenpeace. And he was talking about how we need to reach the masses more. And until you explain the issue to them in a language that they understand, they won't be able to ask or demand it when, like, say, the elections come around. And yeah, that really struck me. That's important. And with that, I want to ask Prateek, because we know Yugma Network does some great work with trying to get the information forward in more languages. So what do you have to say to this?
Right. So Yugma has a sort of a language society where we have volunteers, I think closer to 70 or 80 people who are from almost every state. So any sort of issue or any sort of content that Yugma does, it is always translated into firstly the languages of the affected communities, and then on a variety of basic regional languages. That is sort of what we aim to do, and trying to convert this discourse from just being dominated by English and in the sphere of urban spaces, to convert it into sort of this more multidimensional and sort of involving voices which have been excluded. So about the question about seeing a change in terms of are people more aware and things like that, I feel there is a clear change since I'm a product of that. I always care about, so I think a lot of people do care about the environment and climate change and stuff like that, but it is just this I don't know how to put it, but just this mental training that we've been through, that people literally only care about their jobs, their own careers, their this sort of not thinking of the world as sort of their own, and in order to waiting for someone to make that change, ki yaar koi aur karega, it's always that. And most of the people are justified into thinking that. I mean, living is hard for most working class people. You cannot sort of abandon all of that, abandon all of your responsibilities and think of activism in that sense. So I feel ki people are changing. But again, I feel especially climate justice movements and climate change, it always has that reference point, which is unlike any sort of other movement. For example, if you're arguing about gender justice or any sort of thing, there are no time limits attached, unlike climate change, unlike the climate crisis, which has very clear sort of these irreversible tipping points. So in terms of that, it is, I again always say that it is always clear that it is always too little too late. People are changing, people are coming up with more sort of nuanced understandings of environmental justice and stuff like that. But I still feel that a lot more has to be done. I think even the environmental movement has not really, we haven't been, even though in activist circles, it does seem like it is taking the, it is moving in the direction of accepting environmental justice and understanding how inequities really multiply the impacts of climate change. It is, but I still feel it has to, translate into strict on-ground action. And the third thing that I feel, as well, I also don't find that much acceptance of in even in activist circles, is the importance of courts and is the importance of sort of legal, avenues to making social change. I mean, there are multiple problems. There are a million problems with the courts, and I completely agree with most of the critiques that I think a lot of people here also made. But I still feel there are so many issues that people don't litigate on or just fall under this trap of sort of, you know, arre court jayenge itna paisa lagega, court jayenge itna time lagega, which is all true, I mean, in a way. But I don't think courts ever really hamper movements, and it's always an add-on. And so I just feel that I think in activist circles and in the environmental justice movement, we really need to accept and we really need to use the courts, for our beneficial needs. And so that's just some of the points that I feel that we really need to think about more on. That would be it. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks for that. It actually reminded me of what Priya said in the earlier question, that we need to remember that there are a lot of aspects to every single campaign that we take on, and need to remember that moving forward, that it's not a lone fight. And with that, I want to ask Priya, what thoughts you have on this question that we're discussing right now?
So yeah, most of the things have been said. I do resonate with some things that have already been shared by the other speakers. But in terms of voices being heard, I've always been confused, because are the real voices being heard? That's a question we should keep asking ourselves over and over and over again, I think, because we need to understand that the real voices on the ground are actually not being heard. What are the mediums? Just look at the mediums through which the voices can be amplified and be heard. Those mediums are either social media or mainstream media. Forget the mainstream media. It's totally corporate owned. They only stand by the voices and the voices of the middle class and the elite and the industry, corporations, governments. Where are we, apart from say certain stories on from certain counters, but it's not focused. Journalism in India today, unfortunately, is not focused on that. Then there's social media, but there's a huge question of how many people have access to social media. That leaves us with middle class voices being on the upfront. Now is it bad? No, it's not bad. It's good that, and I have seen that these voices are coming out. Of course, I would like to really, really keep hearing more voices from the ground. I'd really like that this panel would have more people, when we talk about youth, I would really have loved to see more young people from the villages or the rural areas joining this panel discussion, which is very, very much possible, because one of the things that we tried when I was with Greenpeace and we were fighting against the mine in Mahan was basically, we had these different set of strategies for the community and a different set of strategies for the urban middle class young people, because there was this whole thing that said that, young people like cool things, they take up something because it's cool and, the in thing, then they will kind of pick it up. There was all these thing of defining audiences, which are very true. But we did this very interesting exercise of bringing 15 people from the urban spaces, university students, to Mahan, for a month, and picking Mahua. you know, in the forest along with the community during mahua is a forest produce, you know, it's a flower that falls down, you know, falls down from the trees, you know, in the months of April basically, and that's collected by forest dwelling communities in central Indian belt, and that's dried and then sold. We had these 15 young people staying in the village, you know, collecting mahua from dawn to dusk, cooking for themselves, you know, managing everything by themselves. And, you know, the connections that were built with the community, you know, were lifelong. You know, some of them keep, you know, going back, calling, you know, the people in the villages keep, you know, connecting with them for support and all of that. So I think, you know, these kind of, you know, exercises where immersion of youth in rural, you know, spaces is very important. I think, again, you know, the whole thing of technology, you know, one thing I've seen change on the ground for me is technology being used much, much more. You know, what I perhaps think COVID taught us is like, I've not visited Mahan for the past 1.5 years, but I'm still in touch with the community. I'm able to, you know, have longer discussions with them. They've started using WhatsApp calls, even Zoom, you know, they've downloaded. So, you know, which was totally a not thought about thing, right? You know, one wouldn't, when we went and we were regularly going, you know, when COVID was not there, we never thought of, you know, opening up the young people there to this. And we found that once the situation was there, people really opened up to using technology more efficiently and trying to connect and thing. So that is something that is a possibility. I think the politics of language, which was shared, is again very important, because the voices that we hear, unfortunately, are the English-speaking, Hindi-speaking voices. We are not hearing the Gondi's language. We are not hearing, you know, we are not hearing the local dialects of people, you know, and people actually communicate in that language, and the movements on the ground communicate in that thing. The most important thing for me is basically to also say that that we need to acknowledge that we need to build a movement of youth, you know, who cuts across class and across rural-urban divide. And when we build that, we need to keep in mind the fact that, you know, people from the villages are brilliant at strategizing. You know, we have this thinking, or we go with this thinking that, you know, the English speaking middle class people are the ones who are smart at strategizing. No, there are truckloads of knowledge out there, you know, traditional practices which are solutions to climate change, which communities have been practicing for ages and ages, which have not been highlighted. You know, we need to kind of go out there on the ground, and I think that there is a lot out there. It needs to come out from there. And whether it's solutions to climate change, or whether it's strategies, because, you know, the people who are facing climate change and bearing the brunt of climate change on the ground are the ones who are the smartest about strategizing also. We should remember that. So we need to get those voices, not just to participate, but also to take decisions, to actively participate in strategies, you know, to own this campaign as much as any other person from a middle-class youth organization, you know, and that linkage is something that will help us kind of deliver climate justice, which is, I think, the core of what we want, because we are not talking about just climate change. You know, what we are saying is that we want a just transition into renewables. We want, you know, the voices of just climate justice to be, you know, coming from the ground, and that should be, you know, kind of incorporated into our planning, into our negotiations, into our campaigns, into our strategies and everything. So I think that's what I want to just submit.
Yeah, I think that's very important, even for us, like when we organize more panels like this. I think it's important for us to remember that we need more people represented in the future. And on that note, I'm sorry, I love this discussion, but we'll have to wrap up here because there's another session that's going to start soon. I'd like to give the stage to all of you for a quick 30-second final statement, if you'd like. And yeah, I'll start with Prateek.
Hi. I mean, it's just been great being involved with this and engaging with such great ideas. I'd like to really take this forward, as someone said. I think Srijani, and we could really think more on strategizing and thinking on how to really collaborate and sort of think more and, you know, bring that sort of action onto the ground. So we are really, really, really fun being here, and it's really been great. Thank you.
Thanks, Prateek. Thanks for being here. Anna?
It's been so amazing to listen to everyone here, Priya, everybody. Like, I was just listening to Priya right now talking about, you know, bringing more representation. I was thinking of, like, what we have been doing in Latin America with art, what is art versus artists, which is sort of like where we highlight indigenous communities, Dalit communities, DBA communities, basically, and what they're doing in the hinterlands, and how their community-led efforts have been, community-led efforts have led to, like, conservation efforts, basically. So, yeah, that's what I wanted to add to whatever discussion we were just having right now. And I think in that scope itself, we've seen so much change with the way people have been reacting. Of course, there is still that dissonance that the environment is not political, so why are you talking about these issues? Yeah, that's what I wanted to add there. And also, like, definitely what Prateek said, we should be collaborating more, all the synergy right now, all the feeling of community right now. It's very nice to see everyone together. Yeah.
I agree. Thanks, Anna. Archana, any closing statements?
It has been a super, super enriching conversation. So, so happy to be part of this conversation. And I would like to say that let us take ahead this conversation and also ensuring more and more people from the grassroots level and the marginalized community, also passing the mic to the ones who are most impacted and who have the solutions and who have been practicing the solutions. And apart from that, I would like to say, let us all be open to learn and unlearn in this climate justice space, because that is what is important, learn plus unlearning. So yes, thank you everyone. It has been amazing conversation.
Thank you so much for joining us, Archana. Salmin, any closing statements?
It actually felt very nice to, like, talk to like-minded people. It always feels nice. It always feels good to, like, be in a group of people who we can call actually a community, like, who we can actually call people, who have the same mindsets, who have the same mental preferences like us. So kudos to, like, Fridays for Future for, like, holding such an important session once again. So thank you.
Thanks for being here, Salmin. Nupur, any statements?
I think the word community really resonates with all of us right now. Everybody said something that resonated with almost all of us for everything. It's important for us to have these sessions moving forward so that we feel a little lighter, a little happier, but we also are able to work together more harmoniously in future. Hopefully this session becomes a stepping stone that makes us work together as a unit. Thank you so much for holding this session.
Thank you for joining us, Nupur. Srijani, any statements?
Yeah, I mean, I love the vibe here today. A great way to spend World Environment Day. I think I got to learn so much. I think that's about it. Like, of course, I am looking forward to actually engaging with all of you here.
Thanks for joining us. Priya, any final statements?
Thank you, Fridays for Future, for this very interesting conversation. I think when I joined, I was feeling like, am I too old to join this group? But I really, really felt good, you know, being here with all of you and maybe all the others who are on the other side of the screen, maybe. The words that I think that I'd like to leave as my closing statement are solidarities, alliances, diversity, bottom-up strategies, learning, de-learning, as somebody else said, as well as, you know, keep going and remembering to take breaks and supporting each other.
Thank you so much. And we are going to definitely continue this conversation, and we're going to remember all of that and move forward with it. And Lakshit, closing statements from Fridays for Future.
So I want to thank everyone who was attending on both the sides as an audience, as a speaker, for participating and involved, getting involved in this. I really loved it. I wanted, on an individual sense, I wanted to give like two basic arguments for something. One is around how we have been feeling on mental health and eco anxiety, climate anxiety. On that part, I wanted to say that, which I didn't mention earlier, that everyone of us has been, like, not every, but the whole generation has been thinking on this things of global warming, poison in everything we eat, we drive, we do, and unemployment, political instability, and everything. So really, when Greta in that speech said, "You stole my dreams," it was really that thing that dreams that young generation doesn't dream anymore, and they grieve on that part. But there are two ways only from this. One is we can be pessimistic and help in getting things worse, or we can be optimistic and take this forward. There are ways forward and help in like getting opportunities, which we can, and there are opportunities that cannot be allowed to lapse. So we need to think and come together in whichever way possible. More importantly, be inclusive as much as possible of every sector and justice principles. Yeah.
Thank
you guys for attending.
On that note, thank you everyone for joining, audience and panelists. I'll be ending the live now, and thank you so much.
I just want to add, I wanted to thank Tamanna and Tarun for moderating it so beautifully and like coordinating with everyone on an equal opportunity and giving no preference to me. I hate it, but yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I mean,